Good morning and a very warm welcome to our service here from Strathblane Parish Church of Scotland. Good to have you join us for our service today. Today we're going to look at Luke's Gospel, chapter 19. Now we're going to read together verses 1 through to verse 10. So if you have your Bibles, let's read together, beginning there at verse number 1. We read there, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Amen, and may God bless to us this reading from his own special word. Today's passage is a very popular children's Bible story known by all of us, I'm sure. But it's much more than a simple children's Bible story because it reveals the very heart, the very nature, the very essence of who God is. He is one who pursues and seeks after each one of us so that he might draw us into a loving, personal, deep relationship with himself. And when he draws us to himself, he changes our lives forever. We are made anew, new people. As we walk through the story of this short little man, Zacchaeus, let's consider our own spiritual journey and the spiritual journey of those around us as well. First of all, to follow Zacchaeus' example, you need to, number one, recognize your low stature without God, our need of God. Think about Zacchaeus' low stature. He is famous in the Bible for being a short man. Perhaps he was teased as a young child growing up about his height. Perhaps the other children said to him, what's the weather like down there, Zacchaeus? I know what it's like up here, but what's it like down there? I don't know. They may have teased him. But his low stature describes more than merely his physical stature. He probably had a low reputation as well. A low character, if you like. In Zacchaeus' time, tax collectors made their living by charging far more tax than they should. They grew very wealthy by this overcharging. They were regarded as cheats, scoundrels, liars. And Zacchaeus was not only a taxman, tax collector, but he was the head of the department in charge of the whole tax office. The chief tax collector, he is called. And that meant that he was probably a very rich individual indeed, and probably greatly despised by many others, very lonely and probably feeling quite lost. Have you ever wondered if someone else is beyond God's love? Maybe you say they're too wicked. I've met people who have felt too wicked and beyond God's love, but that's not the God of the Bible. No one seems beyond his grace. He gives us a great promise in 1 John chapter 1. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. When we say my sin is just too great or their sin is just too big and too great to be forgiven, what we are really saying is something about the very character of God. We're saying that our God is too small. He cannot help or save someone like that. God is powerless in the light of that character. We're limiting God's redemptive power. And the power of God's mercy and grace. If God then loved someone like Zacchaeus, God can love you and he can love me. And God can love our worst enemy. Romans 8:38 says, nothing can separate us from the love of God, nothing at all. Zacchaeus recognized his need of help. He was very rich, but also felt very empty and hollow inside. So recognize your low estate without God, your need of God. And when you realize you are low, reach high for God's grace. Some of you may have seen a BBC news item last week about a man who lost his wife, sadly, as a result of COVID. Married for 60 years. For 60 years, he said, we were together every single day, never separated. It's not easy when you lose someone you've been with every day for 60 years. He said, I was very low, very depressed, very lonely, all alone in this house with no one to speak to. He got involved in a group of elderly people who telephone each other every single day. And he speaks to people every day, encouraging them. They call him now their friend. He said, it's wonderful when someone calls you their friend. When you know someone else values you and you're important to them. He felt low, alone, very lost. But he found friends. When Zacchaeus went low, he reached out to Jesus, and Jesus became his friend and saved his life. Verse 3 says he wanted to see who Jesus was. What a great goal for life, for each one of us. He heard about this famous rabbi who was healing people and preaching to the masses in the countryside and drawing them to himself, about Jesus who had recently raised Lazarus from the dead just 15 miles away from this location. Now Zacchaeus wanted to see him for himself. And he wasn't going to let his short stature get in the way of wanting to see Jesus. He decided that he would climb a tree. You can imagine the scene, grown man climbing a tree, wearing robes, everyone around saying, what on earth are you doing climbing a tree, a grown man like you? But Zacchaeus didn't seem to care about their criticism, their comments. Whatever it took, no matter what people thought of him, he did what the Bible tells us we must do. Jeremiah 29 says, seek God with all your heart. And Hebrews 11 says, God rewards those who earnestly seek him. And that leads us to our third action. That is to respond to God's personal invitation. Did you notice what Jesus did in the story? He invited himself to Zacchaeus' house. Show me where you live. Let's go to your house for lunch. So here was Jesus, the well-known religious man, inviting himself to Zacchaeus' house. And Jesus put some urgency into the invitation. Verse 5 says, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. I must be with you. Jesus was quite clear. I must draw near to you. I must be close to you. There seemed to be no choice. It was God's will that they would come together in this way. This is the only place in the Bible where Jesus did this, invite himself in this way. And how did Jesus even know what Zacchaeus' name was? Do you ever wondered about that? Maybe Zacchaeus' reputation was the talk of all the town and everyone knew about him. I don't know. Or perhaps it is that God revealed to Jesus this whole thing, said, you must meet Zacchaeus today. Someone said, the devil knows you by your sin, but God knows your sin, but he calls you by your name. God's invitation to you is very personal. Come down, come with me today. After all, he has known you by name from the beginning of time. In today's story, Bible story, Zacchaeus responded well to Jesus' invitation. He embraced Jesus warmly. And that leads us to our fourth response, which is to rebuild a new life. Jesus rebuilds a new character. When Jesus announced publicly that he was going to the house of someone everybody knew to be a low and a selfish individual, the crowds began to criticize Jesus. Why are you going with that individual? He's not worth it. But Jesus never worried about what the crowd thought. He just tried to please his Father in heaven, and his Father had sent him to find the lost and the low. Aren't you glad that Jesus likes to be with sinners, the lost and the low? Because he can reach us. And we all have to admit that we have that label of being lost and low. Remember the people who didn't want anything to do with Jesus, the Savior? They were the people who thought they had no need of a Savior. They weren't low at all. If you are low and in need, then come to Jesus. And yet Jesus' name ironically means God saves. Look how thoroughly God changed Zacchaeus' life. 1 minute he was robbing his fellow countrymen to line his own pocket and his own pockets, and the next minute he had a conversation with Jesus, the details of which we do not have. And then he announced in verse 8, loud enough for all to hear him, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." The verbs that Zacchaeus uses are in the ongoing present tense, as if he is handing out gold coins to the crowd even as he is speaking. "Here I am giving it all away, sharing." Scripture links God's grace with our obedience. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 2, God's kindness is intended to lead us to repentance and change of heart and mind and life. The law in Zacchaeus' day required a cheater to pay back 20%. So why did Zacchaeus give away so much more than 20%? Because his whole life had been turned upside down by this encounter with Jesus Christ. All his material wealth now seemed inconsequential compared to his newfound friend and spiritual life in Christ. Zacchaeus wasn't giving away money to purchase his salvation. He was giving away money because the Savior had changed him. A Christ follower is a giver, not a taker, a blesser, not an extortionist. Jesus calls Zacchaeus a true son of Abraham. He was always culturally a Jew, but now he was spiritually in God's family and household. You don't get saved by your family roots. You get saved when you come to God on your own, confessing your sins to him and receiving forgiveness and life forever, eternal, in a new relationship with God. That brings us to Jesus' closing words. In verse 10, Jesus said, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." Jesus came to seek and to save you and me. He sees us hiding from him, watching him from afar, thinking about him from afar, from a distance. And he calls us by name and he says, "I absolutely must enter into your life and your house. Come close to you, come near, come into your heart, be part of your world and your life." Jesus seeks for us so that he may save us. And he saves us the moment we put our full and complete trust in him, the moment we give him all our sin and our pride and receive God's mercy and forgiveness in return. That's the moment we become a child of God and enter into a loving relationship with God for all eternity. Will you invite Jesus, who is with us today, to be your friend and to be your Savior, today and forevermore? Let's pray together. Father, help me to trust Jesus, to give me my life, to give me the life that God intends for me. Help me to know that Jesus is seeking for me right now, this minute, this moment. There's always an urgency about Jesus seeking for us. He doesn't want to lose or waste any time, but to save us now. He seeks for me so that he may reconcile me to my Father in heaven. Jesus paid the price for all my sin on the cross when he bled and died. Jesus, please forgive all my sin, all that makes me small compared to you, all that comes short of your glory, and help me to realize just how much you have forgiven me as I hand over my sins to you now. And in my fresh start, please let me live purposefully for you. Use my life, my gifts to bless others. And help me to see the Zacchaeuses of this world as you do, as people in desperate need of you, your love and your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining our service today. May you know God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace today, and in the days ahead, in the week ahead.